Hello, I'm Dr. Ron England, and I'm continuing on with a series of animation and the HTML5 canvas. And in this case, what I'm going to show you here is this little animation that's going on right here. Notice when the two squares collide with each other, they turn red. So we're going to talk a little bit today about collision detection, and I'm going to show you a slightly different method for animating than I've shown in some of the past videos. So let's scroll this baby over here and let's take a look at how all this nice stuff occurs here. So looking at the HTML, you'll see that there really are only two things there, and I'm only using one right now. I'm not using the div there. I use that to actually, I usually pop out the positions of the different elements on the page when I need to so that I know where they are and how this whole thing is running. So I'm also, if you look down here, you're going to see that I have a window.requestAnimFrame. That's a shim. It's a shim specifically that brings back an animation frame for the different types of browsers that you might be doing animation with. But the bottom line is it returns an animation frame, which is simply a frame that you can pop an animation into. Let's look at how this guy works. So I'm doing this based on a timer. And if you've looked at the videos on timers, a timer allows you to call a function on a specific time interval. So I'm setting up the timer, and I'm setting the interval of the timer to call a function called callAnimation. Okay, the function is called callAnimation, and it's going to do it every 50 milliseconds. So let's next go down to that function, callAnimation, and take a little bit of look at what it does. Okay, so now I'm going to come down here, find callAnimation. And if you look at this, all call animation does is it requests an animation frame, passing it the function, and the function it's passing it is a call to animate. And it calls the function animate with three arguments: rectangles, canvas, and context. So let's look and see what those are: rectangles, canvas, and context. Well, part of that's pretty simple. Canvas is the actual canvas I declared in my HTML, and the context is just the getContext2D because I'm doing 2D animation. So it allows you to draw, the context allows you to draw on the canvas, and the canvas is the thing that I put on the screen. Okay, well that's pretty straightforward. The other thing that I called here in this call was rectangles. And if you look at my animation, it kind of be obvious that I'm calling rectangles because I've got two rectangles that I'm passing over to the animate function. So let's look at those. All right, well, I defined a rectangle called yellow rectangle, which has an X and Y position, aka a width, a height, a border width, and a fill color of yellow. And I have a green rectangle that I have with a fill color of green, but they have the same properties: X, Y, width, height, border width, border color, fill color. Okay, and I declare those variables so that I can actually use those properties of that variable. Then I set a variable rectangles to be an array, and I set the zero element to yellow rectangle, and I set the one element to the green rectangle. So now I have an array with both rectangles in it called rectangles. Okay, well, that's going to allow me to do some pretty cool things here. So let's go back to call animation again, because we know that's what's getting called over and over again. So it calls the function animate. Now, in this specific situation, what I've done is I've set up a step. Step is a global variable, and I have the step equal to 1 by default, and then as you pass a certain point, I take the step and I multiply it by -1. So basically what I'm doing is if my rectangle 0 has an x of less than 100 or greater than 300, it's going to multiply the step by -1. And then it's going to increment both the green rectangle and the yellow rectangle, the x of the, in this case, the yellow rectangle, and the y of the green rectangle by that step. That's just incrementing the x of one and the y of the other. So what you get is this nice little effect of the x going back and forth, and the y going and the green yellow going back and forth, and the green going up and down. So that's how I'm getting the rectangles to go in the different directions that they're going. Not any magic trick if you've dealt with moving things. And at this point, I haven't drawn the rectangles yet, but I've actually set the X and the Y positions of them, so that I do draw them, they go to a specific location. And I actually do call the context and have it clear the canvas. It clears the entire canvas using this clear rect. Now comes the fun of collision detection. Well, the first thing is that when you notice when these collide, they change color to red. That's just the action I wanted to have. And then they change back to the original color after the collision is over. So the first thing that I have to do is I actually have to store the old fill colors. So I create these two variables here to store the fill color of one and the fill color of the other. Then I have this function called collision where I pass it one and then I pass it to the other. And if the collision returns a true, I'm going to set the fill colors equal to red. And then after I'm done, okay, I can change those fill colors back. After I'm done drawing them, I can change them back. Okay, well, if the collision isn't true, it's never going to change those fill colors, so these variables don't ever get used, but that's just one of the side effects of trying this method that I'm using. Okay, so if there is a collision, I change the fill colors to red, I draw the rectangles here, and then I change the fill colors back to their original colors. So now we just got to look at the collision. And I'm going to actually look at how you do this. It's going to be in two steps. Okay, the first step is I have a function called point is in rectangle. And notice the function itself is pretty explanatory of what it is. I'm testing to see if a point is in a rectangle. Okay, so I have an x and a y. The point has a value of an x and a y, and r is the rectangle that you're testing to see if it's in. So what I'm doing is I'm saying, okay, if the x is greater than the r dot x, and the x is less than the r dot x plus the width, okay, so in other words, you're looking if the x is between the x and the x plus the width of the rectangle, and the y is between the y and the y dot height, it returns a true. That way you know that a point is in the rectangle. If it's not within the rectangle, it returns a false. Well, this is kind of simplifying the whole concept of putting together the mathematics of detecting the collision. This is able to detect a collision with a rectangle. But it only tells you if one point of the rectangle is in the other rectangle. So to detect the entire collision, I have to detect to see if any point of the rectangle is in the other rectangle. So how do I do that? Well, that's in the function collision. It's really straightforward here. I have R1, I have R2, okay? Now, what I do is I say, I call this point is in rectangle and I pass it, okay, the x of R1 and the y of R1, and then I pass it R2. Well, that's the upper left corner of rectangle 1 that I pass to see if it's within rectangle 2. But the rectangle can be inside the other rectangle without that one single point being in there. So what I have to do is I have to check the four corners of the rectangle. Well, that's pretty easy to do. R1 plus R1x plus R1 width is the upper right. Okay, the upper right corner of the rectangle. Then I check the lower right corner of the rectangle. And then I check the lower left corner of the rectangle. So I check the four points of the rectangle. In the end, my effect is to look for this specific collision. Notice that I encapsulated the collision detection into two different functions that can always check to see if one rectangle is within the other rectangle. Notice also that I kept my rectangles, okay, I've made two rectangles and I've put them into an array, so it makes it easier for me to work with that. I can actually simplify this and abstract out the code even more, okay, because I can actually have, let's say I can check a bunch of rectangles, but I'm not going to do that. I just want to keep this simple so it's very simple to understand so that you can get the basic concepts of that I'm animating these guys and I'm actually detecting the collision. That is all for today. Good programming, and hope this is useful for you as you're making all your great games and having to detect collisions between these wonderful rectangles. Thank you very much.